1.6 and a diesel. So it's averagely noisy, averagely fast, and averagely economical.
When you're tootling along, you sometimes wonder, why is everybody staring at me? You see, it feels so normal. It's fine, there's nothing to get used to. You forget that you're in the first fax machine, the first mobile phone, the first of a new generation. It is absolutely brilliant, make no mistake, but it's not perfect. And first of all, there is a woeful lack of grip when you go around corners. It's appalling. Sporty drivers must go elsewhere.
And so must those on a budget. The A-Class may be small, but it's still a Mercedes, so don't expect a bargain. The range will start at £14,000, while a luxury version will cost an astronomical £17,000.
Granted, it is very well equipped. Even the base model will get door-mounted airbags, power steering, electric windows, and a stereo. But tons of other stuff is available. You can have everything from one of these ridiculous clutchless gear changes, which you should avoid, traction control, which you should definitely not avoid. Then there's electric sunshine roof, heated seats, air conditioning. You can have everything on this that you would get in a much larger Mercedes. But £17,000, that is a lot of money.
Mercedes may have started the small car ball rolling, for which they must be congratulated. But I can't see too many people spending that kind of money on a car this size, even if it were made from solid gold.
Eventually, Ford, Vauxhall, Toyota, the big boys, are going to copy the A-Class concept and launch their own versions, which will be a lot cheaper.
But by then, Mercedes will have moved on. They're currently working on a city car with Swatch, the watch people, and it will be a full 3 feet shorter than an A-Class.
Make no mistake, the small car revolution is about to happen. And when it does, the anti-car propaganda will die down. So, you can either get with the program or get on the bus.
Forgive this rather brusque interruption, but I filmed that A-Class item a couple of weeks ago, and since then we've been getting disturbing reports from Scandinavia and Germany that the A-Class's handling might be worse than I first feared. Remember, I called it appalling, but apparently it could even be dangerous. It seems that in extreme conditions, it could turn over. Now, Mercedes have responded by saying that before the car is launched in Britain, it's going to be fitted with a new type of computerized stability device, along with better tyres. I'm still a fan of the A-Class. I still think the idea is a good one, and it's going to catch on. But until we test that new car, I'd hold back.
A sunny day, a country road, and a traditional British sports car in its own habitat of Malvern in Worcestershire. The dream of every red-blooded male and female, of course. And the dream starts here.
If you ordered a Morgan today, you wouldn't see it for 6 years. But then that gives you plenty of time to decide on any engine or colour combination you like.
For those who still like to rattle about on old cart springs, bolted to a ladder chassis and solid rear axle, the new Morgan is the same as the old one, except every panel is different. All future front wings will be pressed aluminium instead of being made in the time-honoured and time-consuming hand-cut and beaten fashion. For those who would have a little man to solder their bits and roll their bodies, then they won't be disappointed. To some, British Racing Green is a must, but you do have access to as many pots of paint as ICI can muster.
You can have your Morgan painted in one of 30,000 different colours, and there's no limit to the interior. One woman who couldn't decide on a leather trim emptied out her handbag and handed it over for a perfect colour match.
But it takes a week's holiday to erect the hood, so wimps and hairdressers would be advised not to apply.
It's the first time I've driven a Morgan, and it's completely different to the normal Euro boxes. Though I can understand its appeal, by offering drivers a retro feel. However, the ride makes my XS flab wobble. The steering wheel is huge and cumbersome. The brakes need a good hard shove, and the seats don't support enough. But that's why people love them.
For those who don't hop over the doors to get in, life has been made a little easier because they're now 2 inches longer.
There's more room in the cockpit than in the old one. The seat runners have been moved back by 2 inches and the dash forward by one to accommodate the optional airbags. Though this means that there's no room for the demist air vents, though the front screen is now electrically heated.
And another concession to modern technology, the steering is now adjustable for rake by, about an inch. Wow.
The driving position isn't great. I feel too close to the wheel, and I feel like I'm driving it with my elbows. One great thing about this Morgan is its 4.6-litre V8 engine, which is an absolute throbber.
With 220 brake in the bows, it shifts. It's a torquey motor that moves from 50 to 70 miles an hour in top in 5.5 seconds. That's quicker than your average TVR, Porsche or Ferrari. It's a bit like an overgrown caterham, but without the charm. I've always wondered why most pre-owned Morgans are advertised with low mileages. Now I think I know. It's more comfortable to travel by wheelbarrow. I also know why Moggy drivers wear flat caps. They make excellent sun visor substitutes. Joking aside, it's a sports car that appeals to traditionalists. It captures a bygone age, a £33,000 antique. And if you wanted the leather sports seats and all the trimmings, it would push the price up by £3,000. Twin airbags would set you back an astonishing £2,000 more. Morgan's commitment to safety reveals itself in a new roll hoop fitted beneath the dashboard, the optional airbags, and the crash testing program at Myra that gave excellent performance in occupant protection.
Although the bonnet has a beautiful view, it's a real pain coming out of T-junctions because you can't see what's coming until it's probably hit you.
The Morgan will never take a family from A to B in comfort. It's not supposed to, but for the less conventional amongst us, it's probably the only way to go. However, our test car had a potentially lethal fault. While being driven, the spot welds on two of the three small tabs holding the steering wheel to the centre hub broke away within minutes of each other, leaving just one tiny area of metal with which to steer the car. Top Gear spoke to Morgan about this, and they assured us that it was an isolated case, that the steering wheel was pre-production and has since been redesigned. No car has been sold with this particular wheel.
Here we are at the London Motor Show on the Top Gear stand, where we are launching our fifth JD Power Top Gear Consumer Satisfaction Survey, our assault on the motor industry. Now, it's incredibly successful. It's the way that we're going to get car manufacturers to make better cars, and it's where you come in. This year, we're looking for N-registration cars. That's those registered between August the 1st, 1995, and July the 31st, 1996. So if you own or drive any of the cars on the following list, we need to hear from you. Now, thousands of you have already rung in, and we've got a lot of makes and models covered, but we need more, so pay attention to that list. If you own or drive any of the cars on that list, simply ring this number, 0800 99 1111. That's 0800 99 1111. We will then send you a questionnaire. You then fill it out, send it back to us, and it goes into the pot. And remember, you are the most important people in this equation because you are the guinea pigs. You are the people who actually test these cars for reliability, not the manufacturers. So if we want build quality to improve, if we want cars to get better and better, it is up to you. So please, please, please dial that number, and between us, we'll make sure we all get the cars we deserve.
They say that the Japanese lack originality. That they are no more than clever copyists. That they have only ever been interested in profit.
So how do you explain this? The Kawasaki Z1, the biggest and baddest superbike of the 70s.
In 69, Honda had unleashed the CB750, but unlike the lean and mean Z1, the CB was squat and stumpy. Both were biking superstars, but the Z1 was Warren Beatty, the CB750, Ned Beatty.
This is a heavy metal mother of a motorcycle with a storming engine and more style than a Jimmy Page guitar solo. But perhaps more importantly, it's got chrome. And as every biker knew, the more chrome you had, the faster you went. And on that front, Kawasaki made certain no one was going to be in any doubt that this was the fastest production bike in the world.
Should you still be in any doubt as to the cataclysmic impact of this motorcycle, let me put things in perspective. This is a 1975 Norton Commando 850, the best that Britain could boast, and it never stood a chance. It was giving away two cylinders, 25 horsepower, 15 miles an hour, and around 30 years of development to the Kawasaki. But hey, it had electric start.
Except that the electric start didn't, wasn't up to the job. And the sound of a Commando being kick-started is the sound of the final nail being hammered into the coffin of the British bike industry.
Big Zs were always horny bikes, but the one that had grown men dribbling into the turnips of their Oxford bags back in 78 was the Turbo. It had a paint job ripped off from one of my old tank tops, but more significantly, it had a dirty great blower, boosting the output of that engine from 80-odd to well over 140 horsepower, but only if you were completely insane. They made fewer than 300 and sold them all in America, which is a good thing, because although it had double discs up front, stopping the thing was like trying to swat an elephant with two rolled-up newspapers. Today, they fetch up to $8,000, but here's a tip. Don't ride it in the rain. But their original affordability meant that most Zeds were bought by young men who should have known better, but honestly couldn't be bothered. In those wild and crazy times, many fell by the wayside. Now, they're being resurrected by a bloke in Lancashire and sold on for big bucks. But who's buying?
Mainly wealthy Japanese businessmen and collectors in Japan as well. There's been an awful lot of interest just recently in the last couple of years due to the fact that previously they were only allowed bikes up to 750cc, a bit of a gentleman's agreement in Japan. Consequently, all the big bikes over 750cc, including the 900s and 1000s, went mainly to America and to Europe. What's happening now is the Japanese are allowed to buy back their own machines and they can't get enough of them, so I'm building them.
What makes the Zed such a classic?
It's debatable, but I would say it was the first of the superbikes. I mean, there was nothing new about it, if you look at it. We'd had the blow-overhead cam before, we'd had disc brakes before, but we'd never had the complete package at an affordable price that your average man in the street could just go and buy from the showroom and have the fastest production bike in the world. It was the ultimate bike, really.
As I'm concerned, if some noodle magnet from Nagasaki wants an old Z1 to use as a paperweight, then that's just fine by me, as long as they keep sending us these. This is the Kawasaki ZRX1100, a right chip off the old block. And that block is the 100 horsepower lump lifted from the world's second fastest superbike and retuned for more bottom end grunt. Plush suspension and six piston brakes keep things relatively sane. But for £7,249, this is one hell of a lot of motorcycle.
The ZRX is the Burt Reynolds of biking. It's big, it's butch, and it's hopelessly unfashionable. But maybe that's why I like it so much. Most of the time, it's as easy and exciting to ride as a Blackpool tram. But should you, in a moment of madness, crack the throttle and send the rev needle roaring round to the red bit, then it turns into the Tokyo bullet train. Oh yes, the Kawasaki ZRX is entirely capable of behaving very badly.
I have a huge regard for London cabbies. I like them a lot. Not only do they have an opinion on everything, but I think that what they do makes rock.
Taxi drivers have been suffering a cab that started life in 1958, a cab that leaked, a cab that rattled, a cab that was cramped. It's time they had a decent motor to tool around in, and now they've got it, the TX1. The TX1 is built by London Taxis International, the largest British-owned car company left. They've spent £20 million developing it and made a point of talking to every cabbie between Kensington and Croydon, because when it comes to opinions, taxi drivers don't hold back.
Will you get a move on? These people...
But pleasing London's 20,000-odd cabbies isn't easy. They wanted the TX1 smaller outside but bigger inside. They wanted the refinement of a saloon but with the unmistakable black cab silhouette. They wanted an awful lot. As the most significant taxi designed for 40 years, the TX1 works well. It's quieter, smoother, bigger, wider and smaller, yet it still has that classic look. With the old model, you had to wear Wellingtons when it rained, but not this one. The cab doesn't leak anymore. There's a 2-year warranty and build quality looks top-notch. Just as well with the average cab covering over 300,000 miles in its life.
So here we are, threading through the London traffic. What do we think? Well, given that most cabbies spend, 50,000 miles a year in this seat, it needs to be the most comfortable in the world, and it's not bad. Driving position is much improved. You've got air conditioning, automatic transmission, power brakes, power steering, even a dubious mock wood dashboard. There's no driver's airbag, and this thing should have more pockets in it than a snooker hall. But there's only one, so where are you going to put all those A to Zs, maps and books of receipts? Performance-wise, it's a 2.7 Nissan turbo diesel, so it's as quick off the mark as the Albert Memorial and makes as much noise as an AK-47 fired through a concrete pillbox. Come on! Where's your signal? But it's not bad. It goes very well, and you've got wonderful, epic visibility. Trouble is, it has a terrifying price tag of £28,000. So it's a lot of money. That's a lot of £1.40s to claim that back. Takes about 4 years to pay one of these things off. Oh, for goodness sake! But I have to say, it's a nice old drive.
But that is only my opinion. We canvassed some cabbies, the fussiest car buyers in the world, and asked them what they thought.
This part here is so much better. It's more like a car, whereas the old taxi was more flatter.
Well, I mean, it's just a bit more luxury. When you spend the amount of hours we do behind the car, you do want the sort of luxury. I mean, air conditioning standard, things like that make a great improvement.
As far as the punter goes, the back is a nice place to be. Lots of room, big wide doors, wheelchair friendly. We've got new jaunty seat coverings, although these silly little yellow inserts here make the seats look like they're ripped. Centre console converts into a baby seat, very good idea. And you've even got a little plug at the back here for charging up your mobile phone, or if you're very sad or very busy, using a laptop computer.
It doesn't look big, but when you sit in it and ride in it, like two people either side, it's quite roomy. I was quite surprised. Because I looked in the back, I thought, it looks smaller than them. The back's coming in like that. But in actual fact, it's quite roomy. Yep.
If you ask 20,000 cab drivers in London to design that cab, we'd all be arguing here for the next 10 years.
But not even the TX1 can compensate for those nightmare fares. Those wretched passengers who think they know it all.
Cross the hotel then, left on Cromwell Road.
Oh, you don't go left on Cromwell Road, you have to go left on Barkston Gardens. It's down the Earl's Court Road drive and then left in Barkston Gardens. He lives in the South Downs and knows nothing.
And make it snappy.
Don't sit behind the Nissan. Don't sit behind the Nissan.
Is that where you're going?
Yes, then left. It is not the other way. Drive, pay no attention, Jim.
Welcome to the ultimate Volvo, the all-wheel drive version of their fearsome V70R. With a price tag of £36,775, only Audi and Mercedes make a more expensive estate. So what do you get for your money? Well, quite a lot, actually.
Aircon, heated seats, alloy wheels, CD player, traction control, fancy upholstery, cruise control.
What you don't get, though, rather surprisingly, is that much driver involvement. OK, the driving position is very good, and the 250 horsepower gives you plenty of straight-line performance. And the lowered chassis, allied to those low-profile tyres, gives a firm, choppy ride that makes the car feel sporty. But when it comes into any real corners, it's all a bit soft and wallowy, with very little feedback through the steering and power assistance that wheezes and whines when put under any load. And I don't actually like the feel of this rather snazzy-looking steering wheel.
But then, of course, it's not supposed to be a GT car. It's just that the V70R doesn't quite live up to its racy image.
So, who's going to fork out nearly 40 grand for a Volvo? Well, there's no doubt they've got a great image at the moment, and the trendy man about town would be more than happy to be seen in one. Or perhaps this is the ultimate dream machine for the caravan man.
Whoever buys it won't be disappointed, though, with the all-round quality and capability of this luxurious sports cruiser.
Citroën's latest family car, the Zara. Remember, your car can go up as well as down if it's a lowrider. And easy riding from BMW, the R1200.